Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Lord, we thank you that we could come into this place of worship this morning and worship you together, Lord. We love you. We're grateful for all that you've given to us and done in our lives. Lord, just pray this morning that your presence would be here and work in our lives. Lord, as you mold us each day and each week to be conformed to the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lived a perfect life and showed us the way that we are to live, as well as the way to eternal life. Lord, just pray that as we open your word this morning as well, that you just give us eager hearts and hearts to understand, hearts that are good soil, to be able to discern what it is you want us to know, what it is that you've put in your word for us. And Lord, today as we gather to pray, I just want to pray for our country, Lord, and all the divisions that are in it, Lord, just especially with the attempted assassination of Donald Trump, Lord, just pray that you bring peace to our country and unify us. Lord, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your faithfulness, O
I have the handheld microphone now. I think my portable is making thunder outside. So now we come to our time of prayer. So you can think about if there's something you'd like to pray for, to ask God for, or something to give Him praise for. Not just think about what needs help in your life, or in the world, but what's going right. Let's all open us up in prayer, and then we'll open it up to you if you feel led and there's something on your heart. God, this morning we come here to praise you, and we come here to give you worship, Lord, for you deserve all our praise. All the glory, Lord, for all the things that you've done in our lives, Lord. And I believe that even though we could see so many of your works and wondrous things and the things that you've done for us, Lord, starting with saving us from our sins, but just all the blessings that you pour out of, Lord, I believe that we're going to get to heaven one day and see exponentially more things that you did for us that we never even knew about, Lord, and that we could praise you even more then. Lord, thank you for your love. Thank you for all of your blessings. Lord, thank you that we're healthy enough, those of us that can be here this morning, just gathered as the family of God, to give you praise and to open and learn your word together. Lord, just pray for us as a church that you just keep us focused on what's important and keep us working together. Lord, I just want to just continue to pray for peace for our nation and for the world, Lord, and especially for all of those that are really shaken up from the shooting that was on the news last night, Lord. Just pray for the family of the bystander that was shot as bullets were fired at Donald Trump, and just pray for those that are in the hospital healing from getting hit with that. Lord, we just put all these things into your hands, Lord. And now I'd like to open up the prayer request of the congregation.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you that we could lift all these things up to you in prayer, Lord, as well as give you praise and thanks. And Lord, all the things that we have laid before you, Lord, just they're yours now. Pray that you would help us to let go of them and to do what your word says as far as not worrying and fretting. Lord, Lord, you want our problems, but it's hard to hand them over. Just pray that you give us the faith to do that today. And pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, Tommy and Eddie here. We want to share with you about a great opportunity happening right here at church.
Yeah. In fact, we have a very special guest here to help us today.
She's my grandmother. I love her so much. I call her Mamaw. Come here, Mamaw. Help us out. Mamaw?
You want to get her to...
Mamaw?
We're getting ready for VBS. It's that wonderful time of the year where children from all over the community join us to learn about the God who loves us so much.
Yes, and my Mamaw has been helping out with VBS for the past 20 years.
43 years?
Well, let's just say a long time.
43 years!
Yeah, but it's really just a... She's never...
I make cookies for the kiddies.
She does. My Mamaw makes some of the best cookies for the kids.
Yeah, if you like the taste of Play-Doh.
What?
Here's the deal. Mamaw needs your help.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
She doesn't.
No,
you do.
I do not.
The whole point of this, now listen, if you'll listen.
Many wonderful people, just like my Mamaw, over the years have helped out with VBS, whether it's been crowd control, making cookies, helping with games, teaching the kids. We want to give you a chance to get involved just to encourage the children through VBS.
So look, let's give Mamaw a break.
I'll give you a break.
Pressure point.
Here's the point. Get involved. This is your time. This is the summer for you to rise up and say, yes, I will be a part of VBS, just like my Mamaw has been for the past 43 years. You kind of passed out.
When'd your Mamaw get here?
She's been here the whole time, buddy.
Oh, it's good to see you. So let's all work together and give Mamaw a rest.
What are you doing?
What? She looks tired.
No. I've had it. That's it. I'll put you to rest.
Oh, what was that?
Okay.
Ow. Okay. Seriously, quit.
Be easy on him, Mamaw. So, there you have it. Get involved. Change some lives this summer. We need you at VBS.
I had a Mamaw. All right, now let's stand together and sing. Everything I believe in.
I'm the fun part. Give me the money. Let's pray. Oh, Father God, thank you so much that we have the privilege and honor to give back to us here in us, Father God. Thank you so much. This is worshiping you, Father God. And thank you that we could do that. One day we'll be forever, Father God. In the meantime, I ask you to bless this money and heaven to use it to glorify you, Father God, and to use it to law.
I'd like you to think back with me to when you were a kid. And while there's a lot of fun when we're kids, there's also a lot of boring stuff when you didn't always get to pick your activities and what you were going to do all day. Those things were probably largely up to your parents. And so while you have a lot of fun as a kid, you also have those times of you just go where your parents go. If your mom wants to go to Macy's, Sears, Emporium, JCPenney's, and Mervyn's, you go and you're just bored. My mom sometimes bribed me with a Slurpee if I behaved through all the department stores. So, made it worth it. But also, you get, before online banking, you get taken to the bank every week to wait in line. And I don't know, not too many things is more boring as a kid than waiting at the bank. Remember, you know, you get bored, I'd go play with the sugar cubes next to the coffee and eat a few of them. If my parents weren't looking. We tell our kids they're lucky they don't have to go wait in line at the bank every week. But one thing as a kid that I never really thought about till I get older, it was just a fact of life, is maybe you go around and you make the rounds once a month and visit some of the older relatives. And some of that was really nice, and some of it, as I remember, was, you know, you knock on the door, you get invited in, maybe offered something to drink, and you sit on the couch and hear the complaints. Sometimes the first part of it would be a guilt trip for not visiting more often, and then it would be a series of complaints. A complaint about every health problem, and then a complaint about the doctor and the medical staff, and then a complaint about the prescriptions, and some more complaints about the the people at the pharmacy and complaints about the neighbors, the grocery store, the waiter, the food at the restaurant, the weather, and on and on. And then if you're there long enough, maybe you get some cookies or a sandwich. I won't, and that's just what you did. Now, just want to ask you, you know, most of the congregation here, many of you are retired. There are children on the other end that come visit you. What will their memories be like? And I'm not going to embarrass the memory of any of my relatives. They're gone now. They're gone now. I love them, but some of my memories were just of lots and lots of complaining. Sometimes the sad thing is, sometimes it's more than anything else. I believe that just ties into the point of a story of Jesus today that we have in Luke chapter 17. I just want to ask you, you know, people, the young people in your family, hopefully they won't remember you for that, most of all. And if you think they might, you have a chance to turn that around. We all complain sometimes. Now, Luke tells this story, and one thing unique to the story is that it is only found in Luke's gospel. A lot of the gospels have a retelling of the same stories. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, there's a comic that has a teacher, and it says, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you need to stay after class because we need to discuss your book reports being so much the same. The innuendo there is that they copied from one another. But most biblical scholars believe a dominant theory that they used the same source material of early sayings of Jesus. And they call this source material the Gospel of Q. You may or may not have heard of it, but Q being a hypothetical early source that they use because, well, Matthew, Mark, and Luke use the same wording for some of their accounts. I mean, too much of the same wording that they wouldn't have, the thinking is that they wouldn't have come up with it word for word on their own, as some of the other stories tell very different aspects of it and have very different wording. But there are a few accounts where they're just so much the same that they believe that there was an early source that they built their gospels off of. No, there's no, as far as I understand, there's no copies of Q or fragmentary evidence of it yet that remains the theory. But they each have their own uniqueness. And this one's unique to Luke. And Luke is special because he was not an eyewitness. Matthew is one of the 12 apostles. Mark, tradition has it, is John Mark, who acted as Peter's scribe, writing down about the life of Jesus for him. Luke, we see in the opening of Luke and Acts that it's written by Luke, who was a physician, commissioned by Theophilus. And nobody knows who Theophilus is, other than he commissioned Luke, so he's called Luke's patron. There are some theories that Luke, even though he was a physician, may have been Theophilus' slave, as some people had slave doctors. So, but again, just a theory. Now, Luke chapter 17, verse 11 through 19, says, "Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, 'Jesus, Master, have pity on us.' When he saw them, he said, 'Go show yourselves to the priests.' And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. He was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, 'Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner?' And then he said to him, 'Rise and go. Your faith has made you well.'" Now, with this, we have several other gospel passages of Jesus healing people with leprosy. But this one has a whole different point. And like some of the gospel accounts, sometimes we really have to think about it to understand it. But this one seems pretty clear that it's about thankfulness and gratitude. We read that 10 lepers were healed, but only one returned in order to thank Jesus. So the meaning here and the purpose isn't too hard to figure out. What the point of it, that God wants us to be thankful. God wants us to have gratitude. And the opposite of being having a thankful heart and having gratitude is being somebody who complains and grumbles. Now, this has Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem a lot, as good religious Jewish males go 3 times a year if they're able to go to the religious festivals and festivities that happen in Jerusalem. So Jesus and his disciples are always going back and forth from Galilee, which is home, to Jerusalem, which is the capital. It's about on foot. It's about a 3-day journey. So they're always going back and forth and probably camping out on the way. And so here he goes between the border of Samaria and Galilee. So no surprise that one of them was a Samaritan there. And it says 10 men had leprosy met him, and they stood at a distance. Now, what is leprosy? Leprosy, well, in the Bible, it applied to kind of a blanket term for all different types of skin disease. But leprosy proper in our day is called Hansen's disease. I'll read you a description of it. It's an infectious disease caused by the bacteria Mycobacterium leprae. It can affect your eyes, skin, mucous membrane, and nerves, causing disfiguring sores and nerve damage. Leprosy has been around since ancient times. For centuries, people isolated and shunned those with leprosy because the disease wasn't understood. Today, effective treatment is available, and there's no need to quarantine people with leprosy. The way leprosy is treated today is doctors prescribe multiple kinds of antibiotics, usually 2 kinds that are given together that can cure it. And contrary to popular belief, it wasn't spread through skin-to-skin contact, where they believe now that it's spread through airborne contact, through breathing it in. Not from touching, as they used to believe. You might recall the scene on the great movie Ben-Hur, where he goes back to find, in search of his mother and sister, and he finds out they have leprosy, and they're living in a leper colony. And there's the scene where he goes to hug them, and it's like, no, don't touch. You can't touch them, or you'll catch it. But then it was a serious thing. If you got leprosy, your life changed drastically. You could no longer live in your community. You could no longer live at home with your family. In order to save everybody else, you were sent away to live in a leper colony on the fringes of society and on the outskirts of town. And if the people would come into town, they were required to keep their distance. They were required to announce themselves and yell unclean from a distance if somebody was going to approach them, so that they wouldn't get too close and catch the disease and they themselves become lepers. Now, why did they have to announce themselves? Well, it might have been easy to cover it up, wear a robe that covers it all, and maybe you could go up to them and maybe if they have it covered, they'd look fine and nobody would know. So they had to announce themselves with unclean just to spare other people from catching a similar fate. And typically people would live in a leper colony until they died, but sometimes the skin condition might clear up and they'd be able to return to society. But it makes sense that they have to announce themselves because, well, when you're sick or having a health problem, depending on what it is, but having an awful lot of things, sometimes you don't look it. You know, even in the past, in my own life, going back a bit over a year, when I had a heart attack, some of the time I was feeling pretty bad afterwards, after it happened, and everybody kept telling me, but you look good, but you look fine. You look fine, you look healthy. I didn't feel at all healthy for a while, but you look good, so, you know, not a way to announce it sometimes. You know, my wife and I joke when things are like that, you know, maybe in order to let other people know, you need to wear some tie-dye and stop shaving. And then people might see the inner reality of, you don't look so good. But we seldom do anything like that. In the Old Testament, there's a few passages that give instructions for leprosy. Numbers 5:2, command the sons of Israel that they send away from the camp every leper and everyone having a discharge and everyone who is unclean because of a dead person. The dead person being that you don't know why they died and you might catch it if it's something contagious. So you're isolated for a short time or quarantined so that you don't accidentally spread around whatever killed the person. Deuteronomy 24:8-9. Be careful against an infection of leprosy, that you diligently observe and do according to all that the Levitical priests teach you, as I have commanded you, so you shall be careful to do. Remember what the Lord your God did to Miriam on that day as you came out of Egypt. And she was struck with leprosy temporarily. Leviticus chapter 13, the whole chapter there pretty much gives instructions. Most of the chapter gives instructions on what to do about leprosy. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, when a man has on the skin of his body swelling or a scab or a bright spot, and it becomes an infection of leprosy on the skin of his body, then he shall be brought to Aaron or the priest, or to one of the sons of the priests. The priest shall look at the mark on the skin of his body, and if the hair in the infection is turned white, and the infection appears to be deeper than the skin of the body, it is an infection of leprosy. When the priest has looked at him, he shall pronounce him unclean. But if the bright spot is white on the skin and does not appear deeper than the skin, and the hair on it has not turned white, then the priest shall isolate him who has the infection for 7 days, and then to see if it goes away, and if they're going to be sent off to a leper colony or not. As I was reading a bit about leprosy and its modern manifestations, there's a lot of information out there. One fun fact that jumped out at me is that armadillos carry leprosy, or can carry leprosy. And this was something on our trip through the Midwest. We'd never seen one out in the wild, so we were trying to see them. We didn't see any walking around, but I saw a dead one on the side of the highway, which was kind of exciting. And as we visited a lot of the national park sites, I'd asked a ranger outside of a park we went to, outside of Amarillo, Texas, where do you see an armadillo? Where do you see them? They're everywhere. They're everywhere. I saw several of them just scurrying around on my way to work this morning. You don't have to look very hard because they're everywhere, but we didn't see them. We saw a lot of neat and interesting animals, but not those. We also wanted to see porcupines, but we went out looking for them, but we didn't see them. Maybe one of the more interesting things is prairie dogs. Hadn't seen them before, but seemed like they were all over North and South Dakota. And when we first got to Theodore Roosevelt National Park in North Dakota, there was just right on the side of the road all these mounds with prairie dogs popping up out of them, going back in their holes, just dozens and dozens of them. So we pulled over and watched it, and as we were watching it for about 10 minutes, I saw something coming over the ridge, and I couldn't tell if it was a coyote or a wolf. So went out and got the binoculars and was watching it. Cameron was watching it with his camera that had a big zoom lens on it. And then the coyote was slowly stalking down. Well, we didn't know if it was a coyote or a wolf till later. Actually, it was kind of far away. We took some pictures, showed it to a park ranger that said, actually, he said, that's a wolf. Wait, let me see it again. No, that's a coyote. But the coyote took off running, grabbed a prairie dog, and took off with it. And Cameron and I both got pictures of that. Mine were grainy as they were a bit from a distance there. But here, back to Jesus and the lepers. So why am I talking about leprosy? Well, it was usually a death sentence. And it wasn't something that you could get and just, it was a slow death, but it wasn't something you could get and just get taken care of and die at home. I mean, you're sent out to fend for yourselves, and your new family is whoever else has the misfortune of being in a leper colony. It's a pretty bad fate. You might live a few more years. You're extremities, fingers, toes, hands, I mean, things start falling off as it progresses before you die. So it makes sense when we learn all this that they stand at a distance and call out with the loud voice, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. As certainly they heard that he has healed other lepers before them. And he's healed people of every kind of disease and infirmity. And when he saw them, he said, go, show yourselves to the priests. I imagine that had to be a bit of a disappointment than just being instantly healed. Go, show yourselves to the priests. You know, I imagine they're looking in their shirt or pulling up their sleeve to see if it's gone yet. Well, but it says, as they went, they were cleansed. I know some of you that know your Bibles are making the connection with Elisha and Naaman in 2 Kings chapter 5. Now, Naaman was a Syrian general that had the misfortune of contracting leprosy. And I believe it was a slave girl that told him, and, you know, in my country, there's a great man of God that has a healing gift. So Naaman, being desperate, knowing that he's probably going to die from this, makes his way to Israel to find Elisha, the man of God. And probably took them a long time to get there. And once they were there, it seemed like it took some doing in order to find him. And he has his entourage of people with him. And when he finally finds the man of God, Elijah, what does Elijah do? Elisha says, basically tells him to go take a bath in the Jordan River several times. Naaman gets mad, saying, he tells me to go take a bath. He tells me to go take a bath, as if I haven't thought about that, as if I haven't had a bath back in Syria, as if I haven't done anything and everything imaginable to get rid of this. And he's fuming. And one of his advisors told you, like, if he told you to do some great or hard or ridiculous thing, would you not have tried it? Well, sure. Well, let's do what he says. And he does what he says and is healed. So in both of these stories, we see some similarities that they both have to follow directions. They both have to have obedience. They have to go. They have to do this small act of faith in order to obtain their healing. And that's interesting. In the Gospels and in Jesus' miracles, we see that faith has a role. We see several other ones where Jesus says, do you believe that I could do this? And we see Jesus, when he goes back to his hometown, the wording's interesting, that says that he could do no miracles there because of their unbelief. So the healings and the miracles do require a small step of faith. And so it says, as they went, they were cleansed. That's all it tells us. We can imagine that they keep pulling up their sleeves or looking in their robe to see, is it gone yet? Did it go away all at once? Did it clear up slowly the further they went? I don't know, but before they get to the priest, one of them saw he was healed. He saw it was all gone. And he came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. It says he was a Samaritan. Well, why is that detail there? Well, is it just there because it's there? Is he just stating the facts? Well, we know that the Samaritans and the Jews both followed the Old Testament, but they worshiped differently. They had some different interpretations of it, and the Samaritans had a mountain they would go to make sacrifices, and the Jewish people were only allowed and authorized to make sacrifices in the temple in Jerusalem. No, it was, you couldn't just go make a sacrifice anywhere. You couldn't make a sacrifice in your backyard or at the edge of town. It had to be at the temple. And so the Samaritans were considered to be half Jewish, having mixed with the Idumean, the two groups argued over where sacrifices were to be made, argued over the interpretation of Scripture, and they were separate. They didn't mix very well. They didn't like each other. They shared a border, and Jesus, a few times in the Gospels, went through Samaria, which was a shortcut, where it's documented that a lot of the Jewish people of the day, going back and forth or making their way to Jerusalem, would sometimes walk an extra day just to get around so that they didn't have to go through Samaria. So there was some animosity there. And so just as we have the parable of the Good Samaritan, the Samaritan who did the right thing, where the priest and the Levite passed by the injured man needing help, here we have the story of the thankful Samaritan. Story of the thankful Samaritan. Now, what about these nine others? Presumably they were Jewish. Presumably they knew better, that they're supposed to have gratitude to God. Well, maybe that was part of the problem. Sometimes when we're raised in a religious community and learn the Bible all our lives, it's easy, real easy, to just take it for granted. You know, sometimes to our shame, a lot of the time it's the people that have lived a life of sin, the people that have fallen into addiction and alcoholism and lots of other problems, that the Lord, when the Lord has plucked them out of that and saved them, sometimes they seem like the most thankful people and the most on fire Christians and the ones that want to tell everybody that'll listen their testimony. That could be part of the issue here. The people who knew better easily take it for granted because why? Well, we've known it all our lives. It's the way it is, and it's easy to become complacent and entitled. Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? Jesus knew they were all healed. Where are the other 9? It seems that Jesus is put off that they didn't come back to say thank you. Well, it's easy for us to shake our head and say those rotten 9, they're entitled, they have no gratitude, where, well, Jesus himself criticized them, the other 9. Yet, sometimes we have to put ourselves in their shoes. They wanted to get to the priest so they could get the Queen Bill of Health signed off on. They wanted to go back to their family. They wanted to go home because they hadn't been allowed to go home. I mean, if they saw their loved ones, it'd be from a distance, hadn't been able to hug or touch any of them. Maybe they wanted to hug their husband or wife or their child, their mom or dad. And they forgot to give thanks to God. She said, has no one returned to give praise to God except for this foreigner? And then he said to him, rise and go, your faith has made you well. NIV has your faith has made you well. Majority of the translations say your faith has saved you. These other ones, were they saved? Or were they just healed? Did they just experience the grace of God? Because a lot of people experience the grace of God without giving any thanks for it and without being saved. A lot of unsaved people, yeah, God does something for them, and they forget to give him thanks, praise. It seems that at least these 9 had obedience. Jesus told them to go to the priest and show themselves, and they did. But obedience and gratitude are not the same thing. In the spiritual life, they can get easily confused. Well, I'm obedient to God. Some people think I'm obedient to God, so he owes me one. The Bible challenges that view that God doesn't owe us.
our salvation is unearned and undeserved, as are the blessings that God gives to us, we see that these ones were obedient, but they lacked gratitude. They just felt that they should be healthy, and they were healthy, so they couldn't wait to get back to their lives. Familiarity, we take things for granted. Here, though, thankfulness. Thankfulness is really the secret and the key to happiness. And we all have that choice that we make in life, each day and each hour of the day. Am I going to choose to be thankful for all the blessings that God has given to me? Am I going to focus on the 95% that's going well in my life? The 95% of the blessings that God has given me, or the 5% of the things that have gone wrong? It's easy to focus on the things that are wrong. You ever get a rock in your shoe or something? Or a sore on your foot? Well, it's real easy to just think only about that and forget about every other part of your body. And that's kind of how it works. We have to remind ourselves to be thankful for all the things that we have. When you pray, remember to think about things to give thanks for. I'll challenge you this week. When you pray, of course we're going to ask God for stuff, but try to think about 10 things to be thankful for. Could be 5, could be 20. I'm just saying 10 because it could be, it's not too easy and not too hard to write down 10 things you're thankful for and then tell them to God. Now think about it. Do you have a habit of doing that? Well, probably most of us don't, but Jesus here expected that people would come back and give thanks and give praise for the things that are going right. Now, if the secret of happiness is gratitude and thanksgiving, what's the secret to misery? Well, the opposite. Complaining. Complaining and grumbling about things. Now, there's a lot of passages in the Bible that talk about grumbling. Grumbling and complaining upset God many, many times in the Bible. And if they upset God so many times in the Bible, and it's in the Bible so many times so that we learn not to do that, how do you think God feels when we complain? If God tells us, we don't think about it, but if God tells us not to complain, and we complain anyway, that's a sin. Well, might not think of complaining as a sin. Why? Because we do it so much? Because everybody does it? Because, like me, I'm sure you grew up just hearing people that just complain all the time. I pulled up some verses about complaining. I just want to read to you a good handful of verses and just sit with that for a minute. Old Testament and New Testament. Philippians 2:14. Do all things without grumbling or disputing. Jesus, John 6:43. Jesus answered and said to them, do not grumble among yourselves. 1 Peter 4:9. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. Numbers 14:27. How long shall I bear with this evil congregation who are grumbling against me? I have heard the complaints of the sons of Israel in which they are making against me. 1 Corinthians 10:10. Do not grumble as some of them did and were destroyed by the destroyer. Exodus 16:7-8. and in the morning you will see the glory of the Lord, for he hears your grumblings against the Lord. And what are we that you grumble against us, Moses said. This will happen when the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and bread to be full in the morning. For the Lord hears your grumblings, which you grumble against him. And what are we? Your grumblings are not against us, but against the Lord. James 5:9. Do not complain, brethren, against one another, so that you yourselves may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing right at the door. 1 Corinthians 10:8-11. Nor let us act immorally as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in one day. Nor let us try the Lord as some of them did, and were destroyed by the serpents. And this is talking about the Exodus. Nor grumble as some of them did, nor were destroyed by the destroyer. I could go on and on. I mean, there is just pages and pages of these verses about complaining. Now, this is just so much throughout the Bible, all throughout the Bible. The Old Testament is full of it. The New Testament is full of it. The teachings of Jesus are full of complaining and lack of thankfulness. Now, if this is such a problem in the Bible, it's in the Bible as a big problem because it's a big problem for us. Because we do it. The antidote to grumbling and complaining, thankfulness and praise. If you're thankful and praise, if you're going around praising the Lord and being thankful, there isn't a lot of room for complaining and grumbling. But we have our days, don't we? Most of us do. There are a few saintly people out there maybe you've met that are just happy all the time. Is it a pharmaceutical, we wonder? Well, we don't know. But consider with me, I don't know what makes the outliers that are like outside the bell curve, outside the standard deviation. There are a few people like that, but it helps to know what makes you grumpy. We all have our pet peeves about things we complain about, but it's good to have some self-awareness. What makes you grumpy? I'll tell you what makes me grumpy. Just being overly tired. Being exhausted makes me grumpy. Being overwhelmed can make me grumpy. Sometimes being hungry, missing a meal makes me grumpy. But you know what, if I know that those things are making me irritable, I can go get some rest. I could go eat something. What about you? What makes you grumpy? If you're aware of it and aware that I'm not in a good mood, you can start getting out that blank piece of paper and writing some things you're thankful for. Or you can try to stay away from other people for a little bit. Take a nap. Have a meal. Focus on Thanksgiving. But bigger picture in life is that we don't take things for granted. We don't have entitlement that we just expect that things are always going to go well. But the story of Jesus and the 10 lepers, I want to leave you with this thought. Will you belong to the company of the one or company of the nine? Your choice. Now, as we close today, we're going to have the worship team come back up. But if you want to know the joy that Jesus gives, if you've not met him, I'd just like to invite you forward to experience his salvation. Or If you need to repent of your complaining and lack of thankfulness, happy to pray with you, or anything else you'd like prayer for, as always, I'll be up at the front. A few announcements and then we'll be dismissed. Usual reminders that there are connect cards in the chair in front of you, and you can either fill out your connect card if you want to put down a prayer request, or if you'd like to join our mailing list, you can leave it on the back table, or as always, you can put it in the offering plate when it goes by. Also, a reminder that you can still give online by bank bill pay or by mail if you wish. And today, I'll say Merry Christmas. It's Christmas in July. What is Christmas in July? Well, Joyce is hosting a Christmas in July at her house. It's a open house from noon to 4 p.m. where she has out the either 70 bins according to Joyce or 90 bins according to Debbie of Christmas decorations that Darwin had collected over his life, that she's putting many of them out if you'd like to have one to remember Darwin by. She's graciously invited us all over for that. Also, next Sunday is our potluck and business meeting, so plan to stick around for that if you're able. As the Skit guys reminded us, Vacation Bible School, VBS, is coming July 29th to August 1st. So, if you're still thinking about signing up, we still have room for helpers. With that, there are signups on the back table for that. Also, this Saturday is a memorial here for Carl, if you're able to make it. That's in the time and everything's in the bulletin for that. Also, just a reminder to check the signups on the back table, watch the announcement scroll, bulletin and website events page for more upcoming events. I'd like to invite everybody to rise for the benediction and we'll be dismissed. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.